look at genetically as a discrete kind of value. And today we're going to be looking at two of them. There's one of them called the epsilon gene, which codes for your beta chain, which is part of your hemoglobin protein, which for those of you who are going into cell biology, I'm sure we'll learn much more about later on. And we're going to be looking at the mitochondrial gene region for what's known as cytochrome. And this is important because mitochondrial genes are separate and distinct from those of the nucleus. And so a lot of phylogeneticists like to look at mitochondrial genes because, one, they're only passed down from the maternal line, which you can use that as a control. And two, they're different from your nuclear genes, so you can compare them across each other. So today we're going to be getting our genetic information from GenBank, which is a free, publicly available database of genetic information. Today we're going to use these data from GenBank to develop our in-groups, and we're going to use goats as our outgroup. So with that, why might we choose goats as an outgroup for our primate analysis? They're mammals but not primates. Yeah. So what do you mean by that?
So they're different enough to be easily classified as basically unrelated,
okay,
but also related enough so that it's a reasonable choice to, like, distinguish things that are close together.
Right. Yeah. So anyone not hear that? Okay. But yeah. What Kevin said was essentially it's kind of like a Goldilocks kind of taxon where it's different enough that we can use it as an outcrop to, or outgroup to differentiate it from the other taxa that we have in question, but it's also similar enough so that it's not crazy different and we can't figure out anything from it, essentially. So today we're going to be looking at RedBase again. You guys already use the data reading tool, but today we're going to be using the alignment tool to essentially have the program line up all of our loci with each other so we can see where any homologies might exist. And we're going to be continuing the packet for next week. And we're going to be investigating these challenges as to when we construct a tree, how do we know it's right, essentially, and how do we get to that point? And yeah, as you guys can remember from last week, we had a couple alternative working hypotheses that were equally valid, but we didn't know which one was really right, so to speak. And there's also the factors of convergences and reversals that happen all the time in fossil record. So those can be really confounding factors for when we're trying to reconstruct these trees, because they can make it really complicated. Couple different factors that make things complicated, really. One of them is looking at how many taxa you have, which could be a good thing or a bad thing, depending on what you want to do with it. How many independent characters you have, which can be taken as more lines of evidence, but also can be taken to make things more complicated. You can look at the number of character state changes that have occurred, the rate of mutation, how much time has actually passed. Getting an absolute, a real value for time involves looking at the fossil record, and then looking at the relative time between whichever speciation that you're looking at. So today, we are going to be, for part two, we're going to be creating a known true tree, so to speak. And we're going to try to reconstruct what we know as the true tree using these molecular data and trying to figure out which ones are correct. So today, an important part is we're going to be keeping the relationships among the true tree constant, but we're going to be varying the length of the tree, which represents the number of mutations from the common ancestor in the intro, the rate of speciation, how quickly taxa diversify or how slowly they diversify, and the number of characters we're using in this analysis, which I said earlier can either simplify things because you have more lines of evidence to suggest a hypothesis, or complicate things because you have a bunch more stuff to do. Simulation tool to make our true tree might look like that. Simulated. The simulation itself, when you're testing your trees against the true tree, is going to begin every time you press OK. You're still going to be using the parsimony and the tree tool up here. Be looking at which components of the tree that you generate are accurate or precise compared to your true tree. So, like I said earlier, and then you're going to reset and try a different tree out, essentially. But the relationships among the true tree are going to be constant. You're just going to be varying those. All these taxa, we have these sister groups, we have the true tree, and essentially this is just a table to conceptualize what you guys are going to be doing today, just like which of these is not like the other comparing contrast. So for E, matches, but it's very well could be the possibility that when you generate a random tree that it doesn't have a single outgroup. So all you need to do for that is you click on start editing the tree, you click on one of the branches, you hold it and you drag it to the nearest node at that level, and then you let go and voila, you have a tree with only one outgroup. And so these are some of the questions that you'll want to be thinking about when you go through the lab today. What they tell you about your lab that you'll be doing today, but also thinking broader scale, how do people who do phylogenetics for a living, how do they think about these questions, and how might they address them? I think that's it. What questions?